We are very pleased this evening. This is the second annual distinguished lectureship that is part of the partnership between the Dornsife College and the Farhang Foundation and our Iranian Studies Initiative. And we're particularly pleased this year to have with us Hamid Naficy. I am not going to introduce him this evening. I'm going to, I've asked, and Michael Renoff of the School of Cinematic Arts has graciously accepted to introduce Hamid. As I understand, he and Hamid are longtime friends. I'll just say that Michael is also a wonderful colleague. He's a distinguished scholar of cinema and documentary film in his own right. I can't think of anyone at USC perhaps better to introduce Hamid than Dr. Renoff. So with that, I will turn the floor over to him, and then we will have our presentation.
Thank you, Lori. It's so right that there be a collaboration amongst several units bringing Professor Naficy here, because Hamid has himself been someone who has helped to put certain words, certain constellations of ideas into at least discussions in cinema and television studies, and also in area studies, not just in the U.S., but really globally. And some of those words include things like accented cinema, exilic cinema, and hybridity. In talking to Hamid and knowing him for these several decades, he is a person with so many different skills and such a rich and varied background. Just to say a little something by way of introduction, I have to say that he was here as an undergraduate a few years ago at USC. He was also here for a period of time as an adjunct professor, and it was our big mistake to ever let him go. But he's had a wonderful and a very distinguished career at other places, including at Rice University, and now at Northwestern for a number of years. He's an endowed chair holder. He's the author of many books, and some of those books have been prize-winning. One of those books is actually a four-volume social history of the Iranian cinema, which makes Hamid not only the world's expert on Iranian cinema, but really the author of probably the most distinguished and most comprehensive study of any national cinema, really in the history of that media. And so that's a great thought, and a great honor to really have done that kind of work over a number of years. The culmination by 2012, when the fourth volume was published, but it represented quite a number of years of life experience and study and research. But the other books, and I just want to say a little something about that series, a four-part series, because it won him the Middle Eastern Studies Association's Fushang Pershariati Iranian Studies Book Award in that year of 2012. And it was also honorable mention for the Catherine Singer Kovacs Prize in Cinema and Media Studies. So when a book, or in this case a book series, wins distinguished awards in multiple fields, that's when you know you're onto something. And so I did mention some of the other books, and I want to just mention one other that's close to my heart, and that is a work that was a little bit earlier in his career. It was an edited collection done with a dear friend of his, the late Tashomi Gabriel, who for many years taught at UCLA. And the name of that book was, he's going to tell me what it was, I'm sure. And I should know, because I remember that book very well.
Otherness and the Media.
Otherness and the Media, the Ethnography of the Imagined and the Imaged. And when I went back, I took that off my shelf and looked at it, and I loved what I saw, because I remember reading it the first time. But it really holds up extremely well. And then these other books that are An Accented Cinema, Exilic and Diasporic Filmmaking, Princeton 2001, I checked that out of our library, and just to kind of refresh my memory.
You didn't buy it?
I bought it and I gave it away. That's what you did with your most prized possession. I got the copy out. No, this is an even better story, because when I got the copy from the Cinematic Arts Library, I could barely read it. It was so marked up. And that is the deepest expression of use There were notes, there was marginalia everywhere. It's a book that has really, really made an impact. So that added to the fact that Hamid, before he became a scholar, he had other lives. And those lives included being a documentary filmmaker. Those lives included being part of, and I just learned about this evening, about helping to start a university in Iran between 73 and 78, Open University of Iran. Maybe you'll tell us a little something about that. But the man has led the life of those nine lives of that cat. And he is some cat. And I'm so glad that he's here. And I hope he'll come back soon. But we're going to have him this evening, and he'll be giving two more talks tomorrow. So thank you very much for being here, and let's get a good welcome to Hamid.
Thank you very much, Michael, for that beautiful introduction. We have had many years together as student, as co-workers, as colleagues, as faculty, as friends. So I appreciate it. Yeah, it's been at least four decades. I came to go to dental school in 1964 at USC. But organic chemistry did me in. I switched. I think I got a grade of 11 or something out of 100. And I was not the only one. I think that was a sort of a gatekeeping course. This was a pre-medical course. And so anyway, thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah. So I want to share with you today a little bit about the sort of the transition from the Pahlavi pre-revolution era cinema to the post-revolution cinema, and begin by here's sort of the summary of what I'm going to talk about. Basically, cinema before the revolution, Iranian cinema was very successful, was commercially viable. By 1974, the film had become industrialized. 52 or so studios were producing films. 92 films were produced annually. These are the fiction films and many documentaries and so forth. Television, a robust television industry was operating in Iran, and many documentaries and animated films were being made. Cinema became an object of a target of destruction during the revolution, this iconoclastic destruction. But then very soon, almost immediately after, a new cinema began to emerge, and I will describe these processes. A little bit of the background of Iranian cinema before the revolution, in order to show you why cinema became a target. The most popular genre film at the time was film Farsi, which was a kind of a denigrated term. It means Persian language film, but the film critics in particular applied this term in a very derogatory sense. And there were two main genres of this cinema, the stew pot cinema, cinema abgushti, for those who know Persian, and the tough guy movies, cinema jahili, or cinema dashmashti, or cinema luti, and these are different versions of this genre. And there were a lot of most of these two genres, the stew pot movies and tough guy movies, were involved he-men, very tough men who were violent and who had a group identity and who fought with each other with knives and machetes and brass knuckles and those sort of things. And they, these movies also involve the women, in particular dancers and singers who showed off their beauty, their sexuality before a diegetic audience, namely men in cabaret and restaurants watching women performing for them. And the camera also, in a very leering way, shot these sequences. I will show you an example of that so you can see what I'm talking about. At the same time, there were lots of foreign films that were popular in Iran. By the mid-70s, the foreign films, in particular the sexploitation movies from US and Italy, were rampant in Iran. Spaghetti westerns, karate movies in the year before the revolution were just completely dominating the screens. At the time, a cartoon came out that sort of showed very clearly the politics of the film Farsi, right? This guy is the director. This is his lure. And of course, this is his fishing rod, right? The lure is a scantily clad woman, which is called sex. And then these are the spectators of the film Farsi. So the director lures them into the cinemas by this presence of the woman. These are some of the posters, which sort of summarize the aesthetics that I just mentioned to you. Men fighting and women showing off their beauty and sexuality. And the titles are also very telling, right? Salome, you can see she's, you know, stands out as the central figure in the movie. And her role probably was no more than, say, a 10-minute song and dance. But the poster, she's dominant. And, you know, there's this, you know, sexual relations there. There is this one, Ussa Karim no Karatim. Very famous actor, Nasser Malik Muti, appeared in many of the films. This is the guy who actually lives in Los Angeles and in the 1980s started a series of about the tough guys in Los Angeles. So dressed in the same way as this guy, except in Beverly Hills, running around with his machete after his nemesis. And I did a book actually on Los Angeles, popular culture of Iranians in Los Angeles in the 1980s, which focused on a lot of these sorts of television shows. So I'm going to show you now a piece from the Ghaysar, the film Ghaysar, which is a tough guy film. Nasser Malik Muti is the main character. And, you know, the clothing is completely coded, very much like the Western. In the Western, the Western hero and the Western villain are dressed in very specific ways, predetermined ways, very coded. And the tough guys are that way as well. And one of the important sequences in these films is a sequence in a bar or in a cafe where men drink and ogle the woman dancing. So here is one of those sequences. I won't tell you the story because it just gets to be too long. But just, you know, look at the gaze of the camera at the woman and the way the woman herself. This actor, the male actor you just saw, sorry, I should tell you because a famous actor, Wasuri, who lives in Los Angeles, very famous Iranian actor, very good actor, his brother has been killed, the guy who you just saw in the other shot, and his sister has committed suicide, so he's out to revenge, and he's come to this bar to gain information. Who is he going to get information from? From the dancer. And that's what this dialogue is about for a second. Oh, sorry. There we go. Now notice when she sings how she's very self-reflexive in film studies parlance. She's aware of what she's doing, she talks about her body, she shows off her moves, and she also makes fun of all the musicians who are playing for her. It's a very interesting performance. I think you get the point. but it's sad to say she actually directed two films around the time of the revolution, wrote three novels, and then became homeless. There's a film that being made about her and shows her she's just living in the streets, eating out of garbage cans and stuff like that. And that's part of the story of this transformation. Which I will get to in just a second. So destroying movie houses and banks and liquor stores, these three institutions were really identified as morally corrupting the country, but also politically, because they were all thought to be related to the West in one way or another. The banks were engaging in usury, the liquor stores were selling booze to everyone, and the movies were stupefying the people. That was the sort of the logic at the time. So movie houses became targets, and I'm just trying to find a section so I can read to you. Movie houses were burned starting from Tabriz when the major demonstrations first occurred. Here we go. The statistics by Tabriz University students revealed that in 1978, 62 banks and 3 movie houses were burned down, and 97 banks and 7 movie houses were destroyed in the demonstrations in Tabriz, credited with setting off the revolution. Soon after, on 27 March 1978, a fire in a poor neighborhood of Tehran reiterated the torching of the movie houses as a new revolutionary tactic. On August 4, 4 motorcyclists firebombed Sheikh-e-Farhang cinema in Isfahan, the only movie house that showed foreign movies in original languages, thus a favorite of foreign nationals and westernized Iranians. This action, along with the destruction of the New American Club in Isfahan, convinced many American consultants in Iran, among them Charles Simkus, the consulate, that someone, this is a quote, someone is trying to scare the foreigners, who are indeed, to a great extent, pillars of support for the Shah. So many movie houses were burned and destroyed on Isfahan's Charbagh Avenue. said one eyewitness to me, that it resembled a burned-out war zone, forcing the closure of the famed Leafy Avenue. The thing that really turned cinema burning into a very powerful emblem and also a criminal act was what happened in August in the Rex Cinema in Abadan. Three people carrying brown paper bags of the kind that Iranians used to carry into the movies with ajil in them, with mixed nuts and seeds to crack during the movies and watch the movies. Except these guys were not carrying mixed nuts in there. They were carrying high-octane aeroplane fluid. And they went in and they doused it, and the film that was being shown was Behruz Basuli acting in it, Kim Yo-yi's film, The Deer, Gavazno. And they doused the all around the cinema with fuel, also the concession stand and the doors, and they set it on fire. Two of them died. They all went back into the cinema because they want to make sure that they would not be associated with setting the fire, stupids that they were. So two of them burned along with 375 other people because the exit doors were locked from the outside. And people for hours outside could hear insiders clamoring and hollering and so forth in order trying to get out. The fire department was ineffectual. And anyway, this became a very tragic event, and there were debates for months as to who was the culprit. The Shah's government accused the clerics of having instigated this, and they, on the other hand, claimed that the Shah's forces had done this. And the Shah by then had already lost credibility. The Shah's government had lost credibility. So by and large, I think the average people perhaps took the side of the revolutionaries, that this was something that was done by the government. But later on, in the trial that occurred, that took place, there was enough proof that indicated that some local clerics had been involved. And Takab Alizade, the guy who survived, wrote his account of what had happened, which I quote extensively in my book. This is I'm going to show you a little bit of the film that shows the kind of anger and mourning that followed this in the cemetery, that followed this event. Some people lost many of their family members. One family lost 11 children. Another family lost 5, so it was really terrible, it galvanized the population. Inside the cinema after the burning. Outside. Now. This is what's left of the victims. Okay, I think. I should say that the object of setting fire to cinemas and destroying them was not to kill people. There's only one or two other cases in which a couple of people died in these fires. Most of the fires were set in the early morning hours when nobody was in the movie houses. But the fact is that by the time the revolution took place, a third of all the movie houses in the country were destroyed. Paramount, Empire, Pacific. Notice the names as well, all Western. So destroying movie, and they call this purification process, the Paksazi, and Paksazi and purification and all of that stuff was a main politics of policy of the government, the new government. Cultural revolution also, cleaning the universities from faculty and students that were their own kinds and so forth. All kinds of purifications took place. So destroying movie houses was one of them. Again, because of their association with amorality and their politics of subjugation of the country. Destroying movie film archives, film and television archives, you know, it doesn't seem like a big deal, but it is because, actually, you know what? I should show you this, sorry, because you will see why that was important, the archives. Okay, here's a scene where the Shah is meeting all of his ministers of the cabinet and dignitary, and this is the prime minister who's reporting to him.
فاکر مفتخر است که از جانب خود و هیئت وزیران و کلیه کارکنان دولت این سعید فطر را به پیشگاه مبارک تبریک و تهنیت عرض کنند.
عید فطر, the Islamic festival of rejoicing which ends the fast of Ramadan. There was no joy in the hall to the dictator.
So one of the reasons that the archives were burned were, I was told when I interviewed the National Film Archive people, was that the people who had been in such films that were broadcast on TV, showing them kissing the hands of the Shah and so forth, they didn't want to have any record of that to be around so that they could be persecuted afterwards. And in some cases, they paid arsonists to go and take out the films from the archives. And in some cases, the arsonists went to the archives in film, the television archives, and burned things down because, again, they held films of the despotic, despised regime. The head of film archives was telling me that outside some of the television stations, you could see on the sidewalks these round, circular, round black marks, and these were the burning marks of all the reels of film that they had brought out of the movie house, out of the archives, threw them on the sidewalks and set them on fire. So much of the, I think, the history of Iran and of Iranian cinema went up in smoke as a result of this. Curbing imports, of course, was a major policy, and anti-revolutionary films, imperialist films, Turkish films, Indians, American movies, all of these one after another were taken off the cinemas. Then came the censoring of domestic movies and film posters. The Iranian film producers engaged in all kinds of very interesting games of subterfuge with the censors. They retitled the film. Some films were retitled four times. And the thing that had changed was basically the title, not much anything else. The most innovative things that they did was covering with magic markers the naked parts of women. So that means a painting with a magic marker is curved for someone in frame after frame after frame after frame, 24 frames a second. So if there's a scene that takes 2 minutes, you can imagine how many hundreds and thousands of frames they have to paint. And of course, they can't do it exactly alike, so it's very obvious that they painted this. And in some cases, they edited some scenes, some sequences. Some films, 100-minute, 120-minute film became 57-minute film, 60-minute. I mean, they were just ridiculous. Things. Existing films were reviewed, and you can see in between 1979 and 81, out of 2,208 existing films, only 252 were deemed appropriate for screening. All the others were shelved. At the time of the revolution, there were some Iranian films were still in circulation in the Persian Gulf countries. I obtained some posters from that time, and guess what? A little bra cup here is painted. A little skirt is painted down here. So muzzling and purging performers was really a major thing. Almost all of the main, there was a big star system that existed in Iran before. The stars were known very well, not only from movies, but also many of them were singers and dancers, so they also were in cabarets, they had records, they appeared on TV shows, they were on the covers of weekly magazines. News magazines, women's magazines, young Jawanon magazine, and so forth and so on. So they were really in circulation tremendously. So curbing them was a major effort and important for the government. They were charged with smuggling, with pornography, with immorality. They were sidelined, some were imprisoned, their properties confiscated. But the most innovative or complicated muzzling was very selective censorship of voices or of faces. If somebody's face was censored but not the voice, guess what that person could do? He could do radio. He could do voiceover narration. He could be involved in dubbing. So this, situationist and selective way of, and medium-specific way was really the kind of stuff that drove many film major actors either into other jobs, like Fardin and Malek Muti, the guy that you saw there, or like Behruz Mosuli, who came abroad and into exile. So they either went into internal exile or external exile. And in some cases, like the dancer that I showed you, she became homeless. She couldn't work anymore, even though she actually claims she wrote three and published three novels. You would see summons like this in public in newspapers, like in Kayhan or Etelaat, calling the names of the actors, that these actors are wanted by the Ministry of Justice. I actually have that video of Shahrzad, if you want to see it a little bit. Yeah. This is sort of the crowdsourcing funding for the film, but it shows enough of it that you can see her situation. Anyways, it's I think many entertainers and who stayed had a hard time, and many others came out, and Los Angeles became sort of the mecca for Iranian artists, filmmakers, musicians, all kinds of people. Right. So then came the attempt to reconstruct cinema, and I am calling this Islamicate cinema, not Islamic cinema, because Islamic cinema really refers to a kind of cinema that is about the religion of Islam. It's about the principles, the tenets of Islam, about the heroes, about the imams and prophets, and stories of Islam. While Islamicate cinema really refers to a cinema that is produced within a predominantly Muslim country, but it's not about religion per se, but it has imbibed certain elements, the cultural elements of Islam, as well as other elements from other religions inside Iran, from Persian Empire, from pre-Islamic elements. And so I think that's more accurately refers to what Iran is after the revolution. It's not necessarily Islamic, it's Islamicate, at least culturally. Politically is another matter. So renaming of the movie houses was one of the first sort of obvious things that they did. And the renaming, as you can see, is very very instrumentalist. It's basically renaming from the Western, predominantly Western names, to predominantly third world post-colonial revolutionary names in support of Palestinian causes and so forth as well. And of course, naming cinemas in after faraway places is not something that is unknown, right? You know, right here in Hollywood, you have the Egyptian, you have the Grammon Chinese, you have, you know, many, every major city has, my city where I live now, Chicago, has Avalon Theater. But you know what that was inspired by? It was inspired by a Persian incense burner found in an antique store in New Orleans. The architect designed the theater after that incense burner. So before the revolution, most of the Iranian cinemas had Western names, Niagara, Empire, Eiffel, you know, all of those names, faraway places, exotic places. In the West, many cinemas had names that exotic places for the Westerners. So there were names of faraway places like Grauman, like the Chinese theater or like the Egyptian and so forth. After the revolution, the names became Jerusalem, Quds, and those sort of things. Cinemas were rebuilt, refurbished. Movie palaces were reestablished with cafes and bookstores and other things around. And another important thing that happened then also was the filming of the uprising and of the revolution and of the war, which almost immediately happened after the revolution. And so a whole new Michael would be interested, a whole new documentary film movement began in Iran, and a new historical consciousness. I was talking to Kamran Shirdel, who was one of the filmmakers who shot a great amount of documentary footage, Super 8 and 16 during the revolution, and he said he was filming, he wanted to film one street over, and he wanted to go in a big garbage bin so that he could see better, but he couldn't get on top of the bin, it was too high. But an old lady was walking by, and she paused for a second, looked at him, and she said, "Young man, why don't you climb on my shoulder and go on top of this garbage bin so you can film?" And he said, "Well, I told him, madam, I'm too big, I have equipment, and so forth, I can't go on in your shoulder." She said, "God damn it, I'm telling you to go climb on my shoulder and film the scene." The point is that there was a kind of historical consciousness by Iranians at the time that something historic was happening and that they should not waste time. Filmmakers were telling me that American networks were paying a lot of money to buy footage that they had shot, but they didn't want to sell it because they felt that this was theirs. This was a historic thing. It should not be sullied by a commercial transaction. So there was that kind of feeling that was really remarkable at the time. Amateurs were filming, professionals were filming. Like the Soviet era, film committees were formed the night before. People would meet and read the announcements and declarations of various groups about what's going to happen tomorrow, and then they would divvy up forces to go uncover everything that they were talking about. Filmmakers, cameramen were, you know, stationing themselves all over the place in unlikely places to shoot an 8 millimeter camera. I'll show you a little bit of this film that shows some of the climate. Whoops, sorry. This is all about say death to the king, death to the king, and so forth. You can see the emblems as well.
Death to the Shah goes from the walls into the throats of the people, forming a rallying cry for wave after wave of protest demonstrations all over the country. The Islamic clergy plays a vital role in mobilizing the protesters out of neighborhood mosques. Calling for an Islamic Republic, the crowd reminds the world of Dr. Mossadegh, the father of Iran's fight against neo-colonialism, and the first third world leader to speak out against this threat to independence.
Sense. And many films were made during this period about this, about the revolution, about the history that led to the revolution, and so forth. Many films. And a lot of these films, opposition filmmakers also began to make films, opposition to the Islamic Revolution. And Los Angeles became a sort of a display place for them. I haunted many UCLA and USC places where posters of various student groups were on displaying films and events that are taking place. This is one at UCLA, for example, showing the days of the uprising in film. This is showing death to imperialism also at Dixon Hall, right? Is that it? It's so small. Yeah, Dixon Hall, UCLA. This is a Mujahideen organized event, a film about their martyrs. This is the Mujahideen's television program, advertising the resistance TV by the Mujahideen. And they would basically, the group would meet at this time, and then they would play the video of that event. The Kurdish resistance movement likewise also had a slideshow, core and the declamation, and films. I went to many of these events. The Baha'is had films as well. This is a music video I'm sure some of you older people have seen. It sort of recreates, it's by a Canadian group, Doug Cameron. It's about this Baha'i teacher in Shiraz who is arrested while she's teaching in class and taken to prison and hanged. So this recreates that event. What's happening? Should be okay. Looks like somehow we lost the sound. Doug, are you here? Yeah. Because even the part that it played a second ago is not playing.
Try it again.
Try it again,
okay? Okay.
So this was produced in Canada. I don't know where they shot it exactly, but that's... Her name is Mona, the teacher. Baha'i, yes.
Thank you.
how it basically ends. So there were, the revolution had the revolution had supporters all around, but the creation of the Islamic Republic had many oppositions of various sorts that I tried to show here a little bit. Crashed. How do you like that? Must be the NSA or the Iranian counterpart. Someone is watching. All right, so it's overloading. Okay, here. So very quickly, something about the creation of the structure. The Ayatollah Khomeini, after he returned to from Paris to Iran, to Tehran, he took the first place that he visited from the airport was the cemetery, Behesht Zahra, and there he, you know, spelled out very clearly that he said, we are not against cinema. We are against a certain kind of cinema, the misuses of cinema. And very quickly, various structures were put into place to create a new cinema. The state, in particular, before the revolution, the state had some role in creating and funding art cinema. The new wave cinema, Mojano films, many of them were funded by state organizations, by television, by the Ministry of Culture and Art, by the Children Institute, and so forth. After the revolution, the state really took over at the beginning, almost all of the aspects of the industry, policy making, regulation, censorship, enforcement, helping the production, importing and exporting, monopolizing all of those things, and created a series of institutions like the Ministry of Culture and Islamic Guidance, Farabi Cinema Foundation. Kanun was the only outfit that really survived the revolution and transitioned from one to the other. Some of the greatest filmmakers after the revolution did their first films before the revolution for Kanun. Kiarostami, Beizai, who else? Those are the two I can't think of. Huh?
Kimiyai.
Kimiyai, that's right. And the private sector was really limiting itself at first to distribution and exhibition of the films. New censorship regulations were approved in 1982. These were very stringent. Even more stringent regulations for production of films was put into place, a five-phase process. So before you got permission to make a film, you had to send your synopsis, plus the names of the actors. Why do you think the names of the actors? Why would they want names of the actors? That's right. This is part of the cleansing process that was institutionalized so that they could not work anymore. And then after you got approval for that, then you would write your script and then you would film your film. Then you show the footage to them. They would give you permission to edit. When you do the rough cut, you would show that to them. Then they would approve it or ask you to change it. And then you would do the final cut and send it to the movies. And most importantly, in some ways, after you got the film approved, then they would assign it to cinemas. And there were, you know, a range of cinemas, the first grade, second grade, third grade, and fourth. So if your film was assigned to a first grade cinema into a high class neighborhood, with lots of customers, with high ticket prices and amenities and so forth, your film would sell much better, critics would write about it and so forth. On the other hand, if your film was assigned to a third or fourth grade theater, small, tiny places with shitty projection, a bad sound system and all that stuff, people wouldn't go there and you wouldn't make money. So in that sense also, the government would guide the films or channel the films into the right or the wrong places. Interestingly, during this period was the emergence of these para-governmental organizations, which were sort of half and half, a half state and half not state. And as a result, they were very powerful. They could claim not to be a state organization at the same time that they had great connections to the state. So they could actually accomplish a lot. And some great work was done. A foundation of the dispossessed became the largest owners of cinemas because all of the cinemas that were captured from the wrong guys were given to the foundation of dispossessed, for example. The Reconstruction Crusade was in charge of taking development to the villages and towns, and it did great work. It brought electricity, it brought water to many outlying villages and towns. It took movies, showed movies to them. And later on became a ministry by itself. Revolutionary Guards, of course, was a rival set up for the armed forces, against the armed forces, and that became the Revolutionary Guard became a very powerful entity. It's the largest, it owns some of the largest industrial plants in the country of all sorts. In 2009, when the sort of green movement began, it bought the majority share in Iran Telecom, and so that's one way that it could control the internet in Iran. Islamic studios came into being, lots of very interesting and professionalization of the industry. National Film Archive became really robust. All filmmakers are required to deposit a copy of their film with the National Archive, so we didn't have that rule before the revolution, so the archive was very spotty. But now they have everything that is produced in Iran. House of Cinema is a conglomerate of unions, of all the unions of motion picture unions, and their fight for the rights of filmmakers and their well-being, their social security, all kinds of things. It's very novel, really. A museum of cinema that includes all of the cameras and equipment from the dawn of cinema to the present. Lots of film festivals. During the Shah's time, cinema was basically Tehran-centric. After the revolutions, its cinema has spread out, really. There are studios in different parts of the country. There are film festivals in different parts of the country. So less Tehran-centric. Lots of curbing and censorship of movies as well. I won't go into that, lots of stuff. And then one of the most, as the time has passed, the evolution has taken place in these structures. For example, those multiple rules of censorship were really eased up so that A-grade directors could go immediately to shooting their films without synopsis, without script approval or anything. And then all they had to do is to show the final cut to the ministry to get permission to exhibit the film. So that's a very good, very welcome thing, right? There's a downside. Yeah, somebody who invests a lot of money in a film is going to watch out and is going to engage in self-censorship to make sure that the film will get approval after he spends all that money on the film. So they become cautious. You know, it's very complicated. The population has at least doubled from 30 to 30 million or so after the time of the revolution to 70 some right now. But the number of movie houses is still not, has not reached the number of movie houses then. Partly is because of technological change. People don't go to the movies as much. They watch them at home. They use satellites. Satellites are banned in Iran, as you know. But everyone has them. I chart this, I think, and it's a very, Iranians are very creative. Both in imposing rules and regulations and in fighting those rules and regulations in very ingenious ways. And so it's, huh? Yeah, I mean, it's, the CIA in 2005 did a study that showed Persian was the fourth largest language in the blogosphere. And yet, it's half of the time various, everything is being filtered. But everybody has anti-filtering programs. And, you know, it's a remarkable, Iranians are very good at reading between the lines, always, right? The problem is that then sometimes they miss the lines. They so want to read the underbelly of things, the undercurrent of things, that they miss the actual real things. So, go figure. I'm almost done. Public funding was very big at first, after the revolution. Private sources began to come in. But the most interesting development really is this development of these independent sector by filmmakers whom you know, because these are the guys whose films come abroad. Kiarostami and Bezoi, Mahmal Baf, and Baniyat and Milani, and you know, all of these sort of art filmmakers whose films are oftentimes, some of whose films are not shown in Iran very much, or in commercial cinemas. They're shown in artsy cinemas. So they are able to make these films through co-production with foreign entities, with foreign television. They also are relying on a third source of funding, which is the foreign audiences. You know, the commercials, these films that are being shown in the US, for example, in movie houses in Los Angeles or in Chicago. A number of cities now have regular annual Iranian film festivals. LA, Houston, Chicago, Boston,
Washington
DC, London, Paris, Switzerland. All of these are, and the Iranians in diaspora, you guys who are here, have actually created a market for Iranian films abroad, and you bring your neighbors, your family, your boyfriends, your girlfriends, your children, and so it actually has, I think you guys, we have been instrumental in creating this sort of independent market. And there's also underground filming that's going on in Iran tremendously, right? I mean, Panahi is officially under house arrest, and he makes his "This is not a film," smuggles it out of the country on a USB stick inside a cake, wins award, and then he makes a second one, and you know, and yet he's supposedly under house arrest. So how is that possible? It's a game of cat and mouse. Most important development is the situation of women. Before the revolution, only one feature film had been made by a woman. Within a decade after the revolution, more women were making films than in all the 8 decades before combined. And now there are dozens of women who are making films, and they're not making only one film, but several, many films, which shows that it has become, filmmaking has become a career for women. It's no longer verboten. People send their daughters to go to acting schools, to film schools, and so forth. And some say partly because of the cleansing process that has occurred. The casting couch is gone, supposedly. But women's representation in cinema underwent several phases. At first, cinema became very male. Not only male produced, but male stories and actors, they were all male. Women were not there. In the mid-1980s, women began to appear in cinema as characters, but they were basically passive characters, background people, housewives. There was an aesthetic of modesty that disembodied the women. Women were not, they had to wear the hijab, but they also had to walk quietly, gently, not very actively, not bend down, because the contours of their body would show, and that would be not good. One famous director said the best way to shoot a woman is to have her be seated. Women were filmed in long shots, no close-ups of a desirous look, shot, reverse shot between a male and a female. And none of these were written. These are just, this is a grammar that evolved. And sometimes they were using, because men and women, even if the two actors were married to each other off the screen, they still couldn't touch. On the screen. So the whole policy of mediating objects evolved. In this case, in Mahmoud Abbas Gabbe, for example, here's this old guy who's in love with the Gabbe, and she's milking the goat with her hands going this way, right? So we have this shot, then we have this shot, then we have this shot, and then her hand going this way. It's very clearly suggests something going on there. but you have, in Bani Etemad's film, about the director, what is it called? Anyway, she has had a fight with her son, adult son, and the son has gone to bed angry. And so she goes to the bedside of her son and wants to caress her and calm her and make up with her. But she can't really touch her, so she touches him through the sheets. Not in a sexual way, but all kinds of mediations. Next time you see earlier eras films, you'll see this kind of stuff going on. And then finally, women became stronger, agential. They drove the plot of the film, more complex images. Before the revolution, women were binary, either houris or whores, houris angels or whores. After the revolution, after the absences, and after those that bad period, women became well-rounded individuals with all kinds of faults and good things. I'll show you a short Rakhshan Bani Etemad film, The May Lady. That's the one that I was going to tell you about. This is about a film director, a documentary film director, who is divorced her husband, but is in love with another guy to whom she's not married, and she wants to raise her son herself, and she wants to continue having her career as a documentary filmmaker, an independent woman. All of these were kind of new. And so she does a remarkable thing in this film. Her lover, her male lover, with whom she converses by telephone, by voice messages, by letters that they write each other and so forth, never appears in the film. So she does a reverse of the female's not being in the film. The male is not in the film. And yet he's present by his voice, by his letters, a kind of epistolary communication that's going on. Very interesting. As you can see, these limitations force Iranian directors to be more creative with their work.
چند وقت با هم زندگی کردن؟
6 دخترش از بشم الان دیگه برم که با هم دعوا نه.
This girl is Bani Yatamat's own daughter. She's now a very famous actor. And I pointed this out because a new interesting development after the revolution is what I'm calling the emergence of a family mode of production. A number of filmmakers, including the Mahmalbaf family, Bani Yatamat and others, are involving their whole family in the project of their films, and sometimes the individual family members make their own films and they collaborate together, sort of like a little private family studio. And that's another interesting phenomenon after revolution. So this girl now is talking to the director of the film, within the film.
از این طرفه اونایی، ها؟
بابا من باید چه بشنستم؟
میدونی همون از چی کار کرد؟ یه روز اومد گفت، هر که هر چی میخواد بگه بگه، هر که هر کار میخواد بکنه بکنه. تو میخوای به من بمونی یا نه؟ با جنوبرم، او برم گفت پس چی؟ معلومه، حتی نمکنه برد من سر اسمشو برد شد. حتی من خواهی شد.
زنوبر داستان نوبر و رسول را برایم میگوید. جسارت آنها را آرزو می کنم که خود همچنان در تردیدم.
So you can see how the female subjectivity comes into this film very powerfully. She not only sees and records films, but her voice and her thinking process comes into the film as well, imbues the film totally. As she's editing.
کاری که شروعش خیلی ساده بود حالا کاملا درگیرم کرده.
So this is the man, her man.
او میگوید تو مادر بودن، همسر بودن و کارت را در مقابل هم میبینی، نه کنار هم. و فکر میکند تردیدهای من از آن روز که نمیتوانم بین خواسته های طبیعیم تعادل برقرار کنم. و چگونه بگویم که تنهای من از آنجاست که هیچ کدام را به قیمت از دست دادن دیگری نمیخواهم.
Now watch this section about the way she uses sound. The voices of the two.
میدانم که نوشته از او خواهم داشت. برای می نویسد.
عزیزترین، می شنوم که تصمیم جایگزین تردیدهایت می شود و ادامه کار متوقف می ماند. هیچ کس باور نخواهد داشت که نگاه تیز و بی‌نفوذ در جامعه پدر سالار نتواند مادری شایسته را پیدا
کند.
مادر نمونه شاید گمنام‌ترین مادری جوان از دست دادی مظلوم باشد. شاید نصرت بانو باشد که دختری چون تو را در دامان خود پرورش داد. شاید مادر من باشد که سپید بود به سپیدی ما و چشم.
So these two guys can't touch each other. And they're not in the same frame. And yet the voices intermingle. Right? I mean, very sensual in many ways. And especially what the content of what they're talking about also is about intimacy and sensuality and closeness. So it's I think, some remarkable films are being made. And then last phase of the women's presence is the use of veil and modesty as political criticism. And you can see this in the streets as well as in the movies, where women are wearing the veils, but they're defying almost all their rules regarding it by the color, by the quality, by how much hair they show, by in fact, the veil, the scarf, has turned the face, has become the proscenium, so that the face is the show. And that's why you see Iranian women are so elaborately engaged in makeup. In one film, a documentary, this about rhinoplasty, this doctor says, "I have done more nose jobs in Iran than all of the surgeons in France." Anyway, the idea that the veil turns the face into a theater, and other things, and women take risks all the time by doing those things, and it is their criticism by overdoing it, by exaggeration, by mimicry, and all of the theories of post-colonial, or other students here, post-colonial resistance is at work. And then suddenly the direct gaze has come in as well. In Beizaghi's famous film, there's one shot in which the Bashu, the frame is empty, and suddenly Bashu rises into the frame with this shot, with her eyes directly looking at the camera, defying the non-direct gaze. So direct gaze has come back in, and in some film, they have begun to shave women's heads. So if there is no hair, then there is also no need for the veil. Yeah? There have been a number of films that played with that game. And lastly, cinema, which at the beginning of the revolution had been turned into the object of hatred, the object of criticism, the object of destruction, iconoclastic destruction. By the end of 30 years or so, cinema became indigenous. As indigenous, as Iranian, as a carpet, as miniature painting, as classical music. And everybody takes pride in being involved in cinema. Mahmoud Wolf made an interesting film, which he dedicated it to the 100th year of cinema. He put an ad in the paper asking for a call for actors. 5,000 people showed up for audition. And he filmed the audition. And see what kind of excuses people bring for why they want to be in the movies. These are all the people waiting in line to get in for audition. This is in a country that a third of the cinemas were destroyed. The before the revolution. Go inside and you can see one of the auditions, one of the interviews.
خب هم علاقه دارم هم به نظر من یک بازیگر به خاطر ایفای نقشه هر شخصیتی میتونه خود اون شخصیت رو از نزدیک درک کنه.
من فکر میکنم توانایی هایی دارم که با واسطه اونها میتونم با دیگران ارتباط برقرار کنم.
You know who this? Do you know who this is? Gabet. This is the woman who acted in the Gabet. So.
بازم ارتان تلویزیون بخاطر صرف هم بخاطر هنرشه بشم بگیم بازم بازی گرد بشم هم باز بیکاری این طرف دارم هم بگیم شده هم بگیم
شده هم سی سن یه وقت داری گریه کنی بره من چکام کنی
خب من که نقش هم بخواه بگیرم
اینکه نقش بازی کنم که بعد که میتون رفت خارج
من هم بگیرم خب من بگیرم بخاطر که مثلا بخواه بگیرم چه خیلی معروف بجام نبخواه بگیرم
بخواهم ترس بزنم کی گریه رو بکنه کی بخنده
بزن چون آوزن تو
فاطمه این دروغ میگه؟ گریه کرده باید چی گریه میکنه؟
چاقه میگه
ده سال
خب
گریه
از
این
میشه
دیگه نتانده هرکه نتانده
I think this is a good spot to stop. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. I think we have a few minutes. Do we have for
sure, as long as you feel
Q&A?
Yes.
There are microphones, I'm told, but I think I'll leave it to Doug to manage the. I can, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. Hands up. The gentleman in the middle, then Michael, then the gentleman over there.
Hello.
Hello.
Okay, so I've been always wondering, despite all that censorship and cleansing process, we still have a lot of actors and actresses that actively fade and were active after the revolution, especially among actors, as I can recall, I don't know, Hamid Khairabadi, or Shahlar Yahi, or Shade Odo, or and a lot of more actors. How that was possible, or what was the process? Why some were chosen as opposed to the others?
I think it has to do with how, with the kinds of movies that they acted in. People who were known for being in sexy scenes, or some actors actually were in, actresses were involved in commercial and advertising for TV. Yeah, like women were very, tiny miniskirts and selling a tank or fans or refrigerators and so forth. But that, I think, would also probably damage their reputation. It just depended on what reputation they had before. By no means all the actors and actresses of the whole revolution were suppressed. But many of them continued, especially those who were trained actors, theater actors, who had not been involved in bad films. Like all the actors who had been involved in new wave films continued to make films after the revolution. Some actors of the whole revolution, like some who acted in the Stupak films, in tragedy films and so forth, tried to sort of cleanse their name by acting in war movies or pro-government films. But those people saw through that was what they were trying to do, and they didn't do very well. Michael and then Joe and all that.
Thank you, Hamid. Lots to process. I want to ask you about the way you come at the study of a national cinema.
Mm-hmm.
There were decades when there were debates about cinema's place in, let's say, base versus superstructure, whether cinema was, as an institution, was simply a kind of reflection of the culture, how the interplay between cinema as something that actually had a deeper embedded influence, whether it was a kind of reflection and really purely superstructural. What you've shown us here seems to suggest a very complex interplay. It seems that cinema is playing many kinds of roles, as well as maybe being reflective of something. But
right.
I wonder if you could flesh that out just a little bit more.
Yeah, I think that's a very good and complicated question. I think national cinemas, actually, this is a discussion we're going to have tomorrow.
tomorrow at noon a seminar with students. I think with especially with globalization and the technological change and with the movements of people across the world, the whole issue of national cinema is even more, has become more under question. Does the national cinema refer to cinema that's produced only within the borders of the nation state? Look at all these Iranians who are here who are making films. And many of them are making films about Iran, but they're making it outside Iran. Look at Kiarostami in the last three films. He's made film in France, in French, with French actors. He's made films in Japan, in Japanese, he doesn't understand. And yet he doesn't leave the country. He stays in the country, he makes films with foreign actors in foreign languages, which are not shown inside the country very much, and win awards outside. Panahi, who's under house arrest, and makes films, and these films are not shown in Iran, but the films go abroad. Or Mahmoud Abbas Abobadi, who have now emigrated to other countries. And then hundreds of others who live in this country or other places, and they make films about Iran or we can't really talk about national cinemas in the simple ways of the past. And a lot of the stuff that people produce here are seen in Iran via satellites. There are 20 or so satellites, as you know, TV satellites, Iranian satellites that are broadcasting in Persian. So the borders are no longer as far east as they were, at the same time that they are harder. Right, we had Fatima Mutamadaria who was supposed to come with the director to Chicago to look at the Iranian film festival that's going on right now. And they were denied visa by the Americans. So, and they were attacked in Iran once their film, the latest film, was shown. So while borders have become porous, they also have become hardened because of all the security measures that governments of various sorts have imposed on. So that's one thing that I think problematizes. The other thing is that national cinemas are, in my books I talk about how subnational, ethnic minorities, immigrants, have been contributors to Iranian cinema. In the same way that minorities were contributed to the Americans, to Hollywood, right? This, the first five direct heads of Hollywood studios were Eastern European or Russian Jews. And that's, then again, and when you talk about national cinema, everybody thinks of Iran as a Muslim society, while Armenians, Jews, Baha'is, Zoroastrians, all of these were, and I'll talk about it tomorrow, all of these were amongst the pioneers of Iranian cinema. So how, so the national really needs to be fleshed out, not only in terms of the institutions, the formations of production and so forth, but also textually, how, in what languages they're produced and what the first Iranians silent feature film carries three intertitles, intertitles in three languages. Already shows you that it considered Iranian audiences to be very diverse, not just Persian. Yes, the gentleman behind you and then the lady in front. The gentleman with the yellow shirt.
My question has to do with the young Iranians. How do they view the sort of Jahili films that you show pre-revolutionary? Do they look at it as nostalgic, as a joke, or revered?
Let's do it right here. What do you young people think of the Jahili films? Have you seen any Jahili films? It's not world cinema. That's right, yeah. It is. I mean, in order to appreciate Jahili cinema, you have to have some background as to where they come from. In a way, the Jahili films are like act very much like genre films. They're based not only on novel themes, more importantly on familiarity. The audience has to recognize the style, the expressions, the language expressions, the body language, the references that they make, the jokes that they make. All of these are things that if you don't know, as a young person who was maybe raised in LA, maybe you haven't been exposed to this encyclopedia of oral tradition, which drives these jokes. You know, you may not appreciate it. I don't know. I haven't studied the young people's take on. Do you have young people in your family?
No, I'm actually more concerned about people in Iran.
Yes. Generation. I don't know. I don't know how younger generation in Iran use these films, because a lot of these films, of course, are not. None of these are being shown in cinemas, but they are available on DVD and cassettes and so forth. But I think by now, perhaps Iranian youth are looking elsewhere instead of back. Yeah. I'm sorry, just the lady had her hand up, and then...
It's not a question. So, comment? I mean, yeah, younger generations in Iran usually watch more like American series dramas. They don't actually watch those giant movies anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Breaking Bad.
Breaking Bad. In English?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or with subtitles.
With subtitles, okay.
How often do I talk?
Well, dubbing Iranians were fantastic artists at dubbing films, and a number of studios developed emerged in Italy to dub Iranian films there, and then of course inside Iran as well. A very long history of dubbing, but all kinds of very strange things also happened, and because the same guy who did John Wayne would do Malek Motihi, or would do the comic, the comic figure in American movies. Very yeah. So there would be crossovers between the Jahili guy and sometimes. And those people who were in the know would notice. And it made those movies more interesting. Huh? Hamid, that's right. You did something. I'm sorry, go ahead.
My question has to do with how you're
going to
talk about. I was just fascinated by learning about the history of all these different layers of subterfuge and duplicity and, you know, getting around the censors, and
that's where negotiations with nuclear negotiations took so long.
Exactly. And so my question is, to what extent, because I come more from a literature background than a cinema background, so I'm always interested in the narrative and the themes, and to what extent is that also finding its way into the thematic content, the narrative preoccupations of the film? I'm thinking especially of the films of Farhadi, where lies are such a big part, and the moral relativism of what constitutes a lie, and whether that's it's okay to lie or if it's not okay to lie, and I guess how that also fits into the cultural landscape as well, if you had any commentary on that.
Yeah, I think the power of these films is really bringing out the sort of the hidden side of Iranian. As I was talking to somebody earlier before the movie, outside, Iranians have a very complex form of behavior. You could call it tarof, you know, ritual courtesy, which means that you're paying attention to your audience. You want to make sure that they are feeling good and so forth. On the other hand, you could look at it the other way and say, and so in the first instance, you could call it the artfulness. And there is a lot of artfulness there. But at the same time, you could call it what it might really be, which is lying or white lies or half lies or... So we have this. This is part of the Iranian society, and it could be something that has evolved over centuries in a country that was the crossroads of civilizations and invasions of various sorts, and and people learn to negotiate. So negotiation, I think, and you see it in the bazaars, you see it in, you know, everywhere. It's, there are some very positive elements to it, but also some negative things. And I think those who come abroad actually sometimes are brought up short when they engage in some of the old fashioned Iranian behavior. And it's easy to accuse the Iranians of lying and duplicity. While they may think that they're being nice and considerate. I don't know, it's a big thing. And it's been, it's not something current, something new. It's from Haji Baba in al-Isfahan to, or even earlier, you have stories of this kind of, yes.
I'd like to know what your thoughts are about the cinema and the role of cinema the last few years in Iran and the progression that made so far from those stages till now, especially the last 3 years. Now, I have another aspect of my question is, as we know, we have many artists as Iranian filmmakers that are actively actually working in Hollywood as far as the DP and directing and this and that. Where do you put that in perspective that as Iranian that we live here now, we have all these opportunities and all the basic freedom, that we haven't even come up with one qualified film that we could put out there as Iranian to the outside. So there was two aspects of cinema. I want to know what your thoughts are actually in Iran first, and where we are now, and where you think it's going to go under this regime in the next few years first.
Well, that is true. There are a lot of Iranians in Hollywood in various positions. And a lot of films, Iranians have made a lot of them abroad, but from those who are very well known or were well known in Iran, like Hamid and so forth, all the way to people who started here. And I've written about these things. It's those who work for Hollywood, unfortunately, by and large, the directors I'm talking about, made films that were very political and not very artistic. And they were unsuccessful. There are either personal films or highly exploiting the bad image of Iran or the mullahs or whatever. Yes, and you know, women are always completely passive, they have nothing to do, nothing to say, and while you see within the country, Iranian women are just really forcefully coming out with images and films and...
what do you think Iranian women last
year? I mean, there's one film that, by what's her name, Maniak Dali, 20 Fingers, a man and a woman are sitting in a car driving in the dark of the night in a country road. They're talking about sexuality. When was the first time you had sex? Oh, when I was in, you know, my uncle or whatever. When you had...
Was it made here?
Huh?
Outside of Iran?
It was made in Iran.
Oh, no, I was talking about actual general cinema in Iran. And actually mainstream TV or cinema, kind of a little different last few years around us. What do you think it is and where things are going to go? Is it going to be a little more progressive, open, or?
I think so. I think cinema and television also, although television in Iran is really is a state TV, by and large, but there are multiple channels. And so for women, for children, for various educational, cultural, mainstream news and so forth. So there are enough venues to allow for different points of views to come out. But I think the most, I haven't really frankly looked at a lot of popular films in Iran. They're harder to see them abroad. They don't come abroad I cannot really tell you that, but films like Aslan Parvaneh's and so forth are popular and people are seeing them, and he's showing Iranians the way they are, warts and all, and makes the film, the films are dynamically made, well acted, tight narratives, good acting. So I think that's the direction that I think he is sort of showing. If you want to make popular films, you have to make compelling films. Because Iranians are now seeing a lot of films from everywhere. And they're not boxed into a limited supply of films. They have things to compare with. So they're not going to go for a bad, crappy, active film. So I think the younger generation, like Parody and so forth, I think are showing a new way to do things. Yeah.
Maybe we can have one more, and then we also want to, Hamid is also coming not from this time zone, and he's been on a plane, so we also want to give him a chance to get a rest before tomorrow, so maybe one last question.
Thank you.
In your opinion, what is the reason that there were no movies made about the 79 revolution itself in Iran, or no major feature movies? You know, I mean, there were so many movies made about the Iran-Iraq war, maybe other subjects, but nothing or no major movie about the revolution itself. So I'm always puzzled why.
Mm-hmm. Your answer is probably as good as mine. I suppose it's a too sensitive a subject. And too complicated a subject. Because anybody who had alternative view about the revolution got his head chopped off.
But
so
in other countries, after other revolutions, a lot of movies made. But
yeah. I think time, it will come. Time will come when those topics, I mean, right under Khatami, another Rouhani, the reformist presidency, things have really opened up. During Khatami, they opened up tremendously. During Rouhani, things are opening up. So it is, I think it is possible to see the build of the revolution. There are more hands up, but
I think we need to draw this to a close. Not because there's not more room to draw.
Tomorrow at 4 o'clock?
Yes, I just wanted to announce we do have a lecture tomorrow, late afternoon, not evening time, beginning at 4 o'clock. It'll be exploring some different types of issues. Maybe you want to just give a two sentences.
Yeah, basically, talk about the way, at least in the last 37 or so years, when there hasn't been any official diplomatic relations between Iran and the West, in particular the U.S., but other Western countries as well. Iranians and Americans and Western governments have been talking to each other indirectly, either in secret. Remember Iran-Contra affairs during Anwar Sanjani and Reagan's presidencies, whereby Iran was whereby Americans were supplying weapons to Iran via Israel. The money from Iran was then channeled by Americans to the Nicaraguan, the Contras, to fight that in Nicaragua. Very complicated thing that nobody knew about except governments until they came up. So the relations were either that way in below the radar, or they were done in plain sight via the media. So looking at the media the last 30 or 40 years, you see an incredible way in which these two countries talk to each other, at each other, by each other, and it's just remarkable. And of course, we are in one of those stages right now where there's negotiation going on, partly in the media. Barack Obama says something, Javad Zarif says something else, somebody else something else. The Israelis say something else. And so anyway, all of these people are talking via the media. and it creates a very contentious media scape. And Iranians, especially those in the U.S., are suffering in many ways because of these images and representations. All Iranians are thought of as being, you know, terrorists or fanatics or mullahs, or the women are considered to be, you know, weak and whatever. So you have to fight those kind of, I think, Iranians who are here constantly find themselves having to fight these representations and stereotypes and so forth. So I'll show a lot of footage, a lot of music, a lot of songs that will surprise you. A pop song, that toilet papers.
We've got some flyers outside about it. It's over at the Adobe Library tomorrow at 4 o'clock. So I hope that's a good advertisement.
Yes.
And
we'll probably end up already.
Thank you all for coming. Hope to see all of you tomorrow evening as well.
Thank you.